Hi, and welcome to this MVA Virtual Academy on Access and Information Protection. My name is Adam Hall. I sit inside the Windows Server Product Group, and today I'm going to take you through two sections around access and information protection. I want to show you what the end user experiences look like for your users out there when you put all of these technology features into play. But then I also want to take you behind the scenes and show you how it all comes together and how you can build this out in your own environment. So we're going to start with a few slides and then we're going to cut over and do some demo. Okay, let's take a look. So first section, end user experiences. If we think about where did we get to? How did we start with access and information protection? And it all starts with the user. The users just want to work in any location on any device. They don't understand they're on a different platform. They just use their device and they expect to have access to all of that information and all the resources, no matter what the device is and no matter what platform that they are on. Those devices are spreading at a rapid rate. We have a large number of new devices coming into the environment. We have iPads, we have Android, we have Windows 8.1, both full Windows and Windows RT as well. How do you cope with all of these devices and how do you manage them in a consistent way? How do we enable these users to work on this platform and make sure that we retain control of all of that information? When we bring apps into that, how do you deliver different applications to different platforms? You've got multiple platforms out there now. Packaging an app once and running on multiple platforms is not always possible. You can have apps for one platform not work on another. How do you deal with each of those? And when you don't have an application for a platform, how are you still able to deliver that application? And then we have the data itself. We have this sort of thought pattern around how do you protect data at rest? When someone copies a file onto an unmanaged device and then they lose that device, or maybe they sell that device, maybe they just give it to their son or their daughter or their brother or their sister, you have no control over that information. And so we've been putting a lot of thought and in our planning for Windows Server 2012 R2 for delivering against all of these challenges. And we think about this in three different ways. Across the users, the devices, the apps, and the data, we think about this in terms of management, we think about this in terms of access control, and then we think about this in terms of data protection. So I'm going to walk you through three sort of areas here. The first is about enabling users. How do you get these users up and running on the device of their choice and enable them to be productive and get access to those resources and to their applications? When you think about hybrid identity, the unification of both on-premises and in the cloud, how do you give access to users when some of those applications and data are sitting on-premises on your file servers, on your application servers, and some of those resources are out in the cloud, maybe sitting on an Office 365 platform? How do you consistently give a single sign-on experience with a common identity to the users so no matter what resource they want to access, it's the same username, the same password, and the same experience? And then we're going to talk about protecting data. How do we make sure that when a user gets access to information, that it remains protected and that it remains secure so that if something happens to that device that you have no control over, you're still able to know that that data is safe, it's secure, and you can rest easy knowing that you're under control. So let's go through some of those scenarios and slides, and then we'll step through the demo as well. Thinking about enabling users and the challenges that we're trying to overcome here are making sure that they can work on the device of their choice and still have access to all of that information. From an IT perspective, you want to make sure that you're retaining control out of everything they have access to. The solutions that we have in Windows Server 2012 R2 are the ability for users to register their devices that are not making them known to you and so that you can take them into account as part of the authentication process. Being able to enroll their device for management so that you can push common configuration information down, things like Wi-Fi profiles, VPN profiles, and certificates. And then making sure that as IT pros, you guys can publish access to these resources in a consistent way. So let's talk about registration and enrollment. And these are two different things, and I'm going to explain the difference between these two things. From a registration point of view, this is about single sign-on and this is about device authentication, the ability for you to do what's called a workplace join, or a user to do a workplace join, I should say. And what this does is creates a record in Active Directory and puts a certificate onto the device. The way that this works is that there is a schema extension for Windows Server 2012 R2. It is supported down to Windows Server 2008, I should say. It will work on 2003, but given that we're out of support lifecycle, that's an unsupported scenario. As we move forward, we're going to create a link between that record in Active Directory and that certificate on the device, meaning that we've got effectively a seamless two-factor authentication happening there. From an internal perspective, this is provisioned through ADFS. ADFS receives that request to do the workplace join and then proxies the record being created into Active Directory. When you go external, then we bring in the web application proxy as the way of publishing that workplace join capability out to the internet. We can also bring multi-factor authentication into this. I'm going to show you what that looks like in the demo and say, it's great that you can register your device, but we're going to make sure that you can prove your identity through a multi-factor authentication. This is going to be delivered down through the new Windows Azure multi-factor authentication service. If we think about enrollment, this is registering for management in the Windows Intune service. And we manage devices in the places in which they live. If they are well-managed domain join machines, then Configuration Manager is the solution there. If they are non-domain joined and out there on the internet, like most BYOD devices are, then that's what Windows Intune is about. And the way that we do this is when the user enrolls for management, we join it to Windows Intune, and then we can push down configuration, make the company portal available to them, and we can also synchronize that information back down onto Configuration Manager. So you have a unified management experience and the ability to see all of your devices and all of your configuration and how your applications have been used across all platforms, all in a single console. The second thing that we've really invested in from an end user perspective in Windows Server 2012 R2 is work folders. And work folders is a file synchronization technology. Just like SkyDrive, which does consumer documents, and SkyDrive Pro, which is about taking SharePoint document libraries offline, work folders is about taking data that is sitting on a file server and enabling it for synchronization to all the user's devices. We can take what's called a work folder sync share, which is a file share on a Server 2012 R2 file server, and enable that for synchronization. The user can then connect to that. I'm going to show you what this looks like in the demo, and they can synchronize all that data down. Now, because it's been synchronized back centrally, A, you have a copy of that data, but B, we can also apply dynamic access control and rights management to that if the data requires that as well. And we're going to see all of this in action. We can also ensure that if we want, we can enforce device registration, workplace join as part of that. So you can set a policy that says you can synchronize your data down to the devices of your choice, but we need you to register with them first, with us first. And what that means is that you know where the data has been synchronized to, because we have that record in Active Directory, we have that certificate on the device to authenticate it, and now we know who the user is and where that data has been synchronized to. From a device point of view, we support 8.1 and iOS at GA. We will have clients for other platforms to follow, and we can also selectively wipe that information. And what that means is if I was to lose my device, I can go into the company portal and I can say, I no longer have this device. Please make sure that no one can access the data. Where possible, we will delete the data on that device. Where we can't delete the data, we will at least render it inaccessible by breaking that certificate key, and meaning that when you try and open it, you're blocked from accessing that information. You can make work folders available both internally and externally, either through just a simple reverse proxy with a URL published, or you can integrate work folders with ADFS and do those device claims and put additional authentication mechanisms around that. All of this is back-end with Active Directory. Part of that schema extension that we did for Workplace Join also enables us to publish discovery for work folders, and we'll see what that looks like for domain join devices. From a remote access point of view, which I'll cover just quickly, we have direct access, which has not changed from Windows Server 2012. This is the domain joined, always on connection. We have traditional VPNs, which I'm sure you're all well aware of, the ability to do an on-demand connection. But we also now have automatic VPNs. And this is the ability for us to map an application against a VPN profile such that when the user launches an application, it will automatically trigger the VPN that is required to get to the backend data at the same time. From a hybrid identity point of view, from a user perspective, this is all about single sign-on. This is providing to me as a user that I have one username and one password and I'll get access to all my resources no matter where they are. We'll take a look at what that looks like from the IT side in a second. But from the user's point of view, we have three experiences that are happening here. The first is the current one, which where they're not joined at all. We know nothing about this device. It's just a standard non-managed device. We have the new workplace join. And when we do that, the device is now known and we can apply additional policy to that. And of course, we have the traditional domain join machine for Windows in an Active Directory. From a single sign-on point of view, when we know nothing about your device, we can really only do browser single sign-on. And this is the classic remember me tick box that you'll find on in any browser when you hit sites. What that does is creates a session cookie with all that encrypted data. When the site asks for those credentials, it presents it on your behalf. And we can do that on most modern browsers across most platforms, and that works today. When we do a workplace join, we can now also do a seamless two-factor auth. We have that certificate, we have that record, username and password, plus the certificate and the record give us that seamless two-factor authentication. We can also do enterprise app single sign-on, where once you've authenticated against one device, or one device against one application, I should say, then you can also get access to other devices. And then, of course, from a domain join point of view, we can do everything, including the desktop single sign-on across multiple desktop applications, not just web applications as well. From a data protection point of view, that synchronization of work folders back is really about protecting the data, and it's making sure that you remain compliant. And the way that we do that is not only through work folders being able to synchronize back and making sure that we can access that, we may want to put protection around that for central auditing, being compliant, meeting regulatory compliance needs. But we can also use desktop virtualization. And you can watch the other session on VDI and remote desktop to see the details around this. But from our point of view, from a data point of view, I should say, you can leverage those technologies, A, to give access to platforms that currently can't have a native application on them, or B, where you've got centralized data where you don't want to allow access to anything beyond the data center. So with that, we're going to cut over to some demo, and we're going to look at two different environments here. We're going to take a look at how Windows 8.1 is delivering a seamless experience for registration and accessing resources. We're also going to take a look at this on the cross-platform and how we're supporting those environments as well. So I'm going to start here with my 8.1 device, and I'm going to bring up a remote window. I'm sure we'll come up on the screen in just a sec. Okay. All right. So here I have an 8.1 client. It is sitting here. It is not joined to any domain. It is sitting here. It's just a default installation out of the box. So what I'm going to do is try and connect to some resources that I have. I'm going to bring up a web browser, and I'm going to try and browse to a resource that has been published to me, a SharePoint site, sharepoint.contosodemo.com. Now, as you see, this has redirected me to ADFS. This is the Active Directory Federation Services logon, where it's saying you need to sign in order to have access to that. You'll note down the bottom that there is a warning here that says contosodemo.com may require device registration. So let's go ahead and sign in with our credentials and see what happens. Here's my user account, and I will sign in using that. Now what you can see is that I've got an access denied message, but it's not just any access denied message. This is telling me that I do need to register my device. I need to complete a workplace join in order to have access to this resource. On 8.1, this is built into the modern control panel, and for iOS, which we'll take a look at in just a minute, there is a link that we can click on there. So I'm going to close down that browser. I'm going to bring up the modern control panel. Under the network node, there is a new module for workplace. And here is where I can complete both the device registration, which is the top join button, and also enroll for management through Windows Intune. So let's do the workplace join. I'm going to enter my user ID and click join. And this is going to connect me to the ADFS again. And this is going to take me through the process of completing the workplace join. there's my credentials, and I click sign in. Now, as you'll notice, we've placed additional multi-factor authentication requirements around this. So I'm going to have to take a phone factor call. This has been rebadged as Windows Azure Multi-Factor Authentication. This is going to give me a call on my cell phone, and it's going to ask me to authenticate myself. So I'm going to click continue. I'm going to pick up my phone, which should ring in just a moment, and I'll hold it up to the microphone so you can hear it as well. Just wait for that call to come through, which hopefully that works okay. Just getting some signal. All right, let's just click that. Oh, no, that hasn't worked. All right, let me just try that one more time. I think I was having a signal issue at that point in time. Aha, here it comes now.
Thank you for using Microsoft's sign-in verification system. Please enter your PIN followed by the pound key to finish your verification.
So I'm going to enter my PIN and hit the hash key. And as you'll see, I have not touched the screen any further. All right, I can hang up. Now what happened there is I received the call, I entered my PIN code, multi-factor authentication verified that I was who I said I was, I knew my PIN code, I typed it in, it passed that authentication back to ADFS, and I have now completed the workplace join. So now that we've done that, let's go and take a look and see what that looks like when we try and access that resource again. Let's go and take a look. We'll be asked to authenticate one more time. Remember, I have not successfully authenticated yet, so it doesn't know who I am. And that is now going to pass it through. It's going to check that my device is registered, which it is. It's going to verify the certificate that is on this virtual machine and say, does the certificate on the device match the record that I have in Active Directory? Are the thumbprints the same? And as you can see, that SharePoint site is now loading up and I have access to resources. So what I've done there is through a simple process of registering my device, I've gained access to those resources that otherwise I would not have had access to unless I was on a well-managed device. And there's the SharePoint site that is now finished loading. So that's the experience on Windows 8.1. I also want to show you what that looks like on an iPad. So we're going to go through that same experience, but show you how the workplace join looks on an iPad, and we'll go through that same process. So I will just unlock the iPad and make sure that comes up on the demo screen okay. There it is. Okay, so let's go and go to that same site. And SharePoint.contoso.demo.com. I'll enter those same credentials. And again, there's that access denied message. This time though, I don't have a modern control panel to go through, so I need to click on the iOS device, click here to join your workplace. I'll click joining there. It's again going to give me that same message that it's going to do a multi-factor authentication call. I'll click continue. Now that I have service on my phone, we should get that call straight away. Here it comes.
Using Microsoft's sign-in verification system.
And we should see that that is now continued on. All right, so we'll hang up that phone call. And now what you see here is that we're going to install a profile onto the iPad, which is how we do the workplace join. So we're going to click install, and it's going to give me a warning. Are you sure? Yes, I am sure. It's going to carry on. You can see it's generating the key. It's going to go through, create the certificate, and then install it onto the device. It's now enrolled it. And in just a minute, that will finish enrolling the certificate. And the profile has now been installed. We can see that certificate is there. So let's close that down. Let's go back to contosodemo.com and attempt to log in. And now that we have done that registration, we're going to get all the way through, and there is that same SharePoint site on the iPad. Let's just do a quick recap to close out this section. So when we were looking at empowering users, we showed the simple registration. I showed you where you could do the enrollment for Windows Intune, which we'll cover in a separate topic. The ability to automatically connect to those resources through automatic VPNs as well as on demand. And we want to make sure that this experience is consistent, as you saw with the registration process across those devices. When we talk about the unification of the environment and that common identity, we got a single sign-on no matter what kind of resources that we're accessing. And then from a protecting your data point of view, we're going to take a look in the next section at how work folders works and is how we bring that compliance aspect into the equation. So thank you very much for being part of this Access Information Protection End User Experiences segment, and I look forward to seeing you in the next one.